and thank you all for coming. My name is Stephen Humphreys, and I teach law here at the London School of Economics. And it is really a huge pleasure and honor to introduce to you Fleur Johns, who is currently a visiting Shimizu professor here at LSE Law. Fleur comes to us from UNSW Sydney, where she's a professor of law and associate dean of research. And I think it's no exaggeration to say that she is one of the most interesting and innovative scholars in international law today. She has a background in art history as well as corporate law practice, and her work shows an abiding concern with emerging and latent forms of transnational governance. She has a particular eye on the aesthetic and the anthropological. Fleur works across a vast terrain of methodological and thematic areas. Methodologically, she uniquely combines empiricism, ethnographic, and theoretical reflection. Thematically, perhaps nothing better shows her range than the titles of her work. In 2005, Fleur exploded the then popular notion that Guantanamo Bay was a legal black hole, with her immensely influential article of that time, Guantanamo Bay and the Annihilation of the Exception. Since then, we've had the following. You ready for a list? Automating judgment, judging automation. Human, non-human alliances in international law and policy. Non-law, or how to make a submachine gun in international law. Data mining as global governance. Theorizing the corporation in international law. Data territories, changing architectures of association in international law. Global governance through the pairing of list and algorithm. And of course, her books on the Mekong and on non-legality in international law, subtitled Unruly Law, showing, I think, Fleur's penchant for the perfect pun and my own addiction for the asinine alliteration. Fleur's talk tonight is entitled From Planning to Prototypes, New Ways of Seeing Like a State. Her title harking back, of course, to James Scott's influential 1999 book, Seeing Like a State. And following her talk, Stuart Motha, we're very fortunate to have Stuart from Birkbeck Law School, who will offer his reflections. Stuart is currently acting dean at Birkbeck. So the format is Fleur will talk for about 40 minutes, Stuart will respond, and then we'll open to the floor for questions. Over to you, Fleur.
Thank you so much, Stephen. I was reflecting today that if there was some Emily Post-style guide to how to be the perfect academic host, then Stephen should be either the author or on the cover, or possibly both. I can't thank you enough for inviting me here and just being such a kind and generous host, as everyone really has been here at the LSE. It's been a wonderful couple of weeks. Particular thanks to Rachel Yarram and Bradley Barlow for all sorts of logistical assistance. And thanks so much to Stuart for coming along tonight and engaging with this work. It's fantastic to be back in conversation. So, from London, let me take you some 12,000 kilometres away to another place, another big city, bigger in fact than London, Indonesia's capital city, Jakarta, home to some 10 million people. It's a short walk across one of Jakarta's busiest intersections between Indonesia's National Development Planning Agency, known as Bappenas, and Pulse Lab Jakarta, a joint initiative of Bappenas and the United Nations, opened in 2012. This evening, I want to take you on this walk and convey something of the approach at each of these two locations. And I do so because I see the short distance between them and their slightly different ways of working as emblematic of a change, or perhaps rather a set of changes, underway in contemporary global governance. These changes pose, I think, some significant challenges for scholars and practitioners of law and development and international law and other cognate fields. They do so perhaps especially for scholars of critical international law and those who otherwise frame their work as calling into question prevailing frameworks of power. While many of us have been hard at work critiquing, unpacking, interrogating, mapping, and reimagining techniques and institutions of global governance, the mainstream of global governance has changed course. Practices of governance in many settings, including in the development context, have taken on a new valence. Those old nemeses and beloved dancing partners of international legal scholarship, the state, international institutions, and other vectors of top-down governance, they've learned some new steps, picked up some new rhythms and routines. And in so doing, governments and international institutions may quite possibly have outrun or blunted the standard tools of critical and progressive international lawyers, among them appeals to history, context, language, the grassroots. Not everything is new, of course, and not everything in international lawyers' critical repertoire is obsolete, far from it. But there have nonetheless been some important shifts to which attention must be paid, or so I aim to persuade you this evening, as we take an imaginary walk back and forth between Bapanas and Pulse Lab Jakarta together. So before we get into the detail of these new ways of seeing like a state to which my title alludes, let me paint you some pictures of these two locations. As I do so, it's important to note that mine are composite and impressionistic renderings of these institutions. I'm not going to give you anything like an accurate overview of the many valuable programs that they have underway. Bapanas and Pulse Lab Jakarta, as they appear in this talk, are stylized signposts that I'm using to mark a particular type of change. There is much, much more that could be said about these institutions and those who work in them, to whom I will not do justice here. Bapanas occupies a low-lying 20th century building, surrounded by a car park and some patches of tropical garden. Inside, one makes one's way through corridors lined with wood panelling that has slightly buckled in the humidity, walking below musty ceiling tiles and in and out of small elevators fronted in fawn marble. Wicker chairs and pot plants squat in corners. There is much coming and going. When I was there, there was an international conference on best development practices and policies taking place on the ground floor. Organisations and programs of all sorts had set up stalls in the foyer outside the main conference room, creating a marketplace atmosphere. Keynote speakers addressed the audience in English and Bahasa, among them a World Bank social development specialist who spoke of the need to work with, quote, good enough data now, rather than wait for fully validated evidence that might become available in 3 years' time. Staff wore the short-sleeved batik shirts and wrap skirts common throughout Jakarta. Some women wore the veil, some not. The people with whom I met there were educated, impressive, and highly experienced in wrestling with the challenges of development planning for a population of nearly 250 million people spread across five main islands, but many thousands more, spanning some 1.9 million square kilometres. Long seen as among the most powerful of Indonesian government bodies, Bapanas has been leading Indonesia's national development effort since its creation by President Sukarno in 1963, more or less as a successor to the Economic Strategy Thinker Committee, created in 1947 in the course of Indonesia wresting independence from the Netherlands. Throughout the 20th century, of which Bapanas will, for our purposes, be emblematic, modern states have pursued what anthropologist James C. Scott famously characterised as projects of legibility and simplification. Maps, censuses, uniform measures, universal naming conventions, population studies, national economic plans, these are the measures by which modern states have taken stock of their subjects, interests, and territories. Scott was particularly concerned, as you know, to try to understand the failure of some of the great utopian social engineering schemes of the 20th century. Those failures Scott attributed to the coincidence of high modernist ideology, political authoritarianism, and a prostrate civil society. Now, Bapanas is not, I believe, emblematic of that pernicious combination that Scott documented. What Bapanas does betray, however, is an enduring commitment to the kind of transformative state simplifications that Scott described, that is, to the production of comprehensive maps of a citizenry with a view to its reformist organisation and synoptic measurement. In Indonesia, Bapanas has been and remains a key propagator of governance techniques of this type. Tasked with creating a quality national development plan, Bapanas currently has three such plans in circulation. First is a long-term development plan spanning the period 2005 to 2025. And this is then divided into 4 5-year medium-term development plans, the current one for the period 2015 to 2019. And in 2011, it unveiled a master plan for acceleration and expansion of Indonesia's economic development. The last of these aims to see Indonesia becoming one of the world's top 10 largest economies by 2025, a goal to be achieved through investment in the order of US $470 billion, most of it to be channeled through public-private partnerships. Now, as that reference to public-private partnerships makes clear, Bapanas has moved with the times over the course of the 20th and 21st centuries. As well as being a national planning agency, it casts itself as a strategic think tank, an important source of data, studies, and advice for the president, national ministries, and local governments. And far from being singular in its outlook, Bapanas has engaged extensively with local government and communities, especially in light of the decentralisation that followed the fall of President Suharto's regime in 1998. For nearly two decades, Bapanas has run an experimental programme of community development promotion through provision of block grants, capacity building and technical assistance to sub-districts comprised of around 20 villages known as kecamatan. Even the most decentralised, locally oriented of Bapanas's programmes, however, still exhibit much of the sensibility that Scott described. Those who rolled out the KDP, the Kecamatan Development Programme, in the late 1990s, which was Indonesia's initial programme of community-based development support, conceived of it as a nationwide programme that would target the poorest sub-districts and the most marginal people within them. The identification of these priority targets was carried out initially on the basis of census data, nationwide surveys of spending and infrastructure, and demographic studies on a nationwide basis. Resources were distributed on a competitive basis. KDP was predicated in this way on standardised measurement and discipline by a small number of national objectives, namely development promotion and monitoring, anti-corruption, and the uniform inculcation of competitive reformist ambitions. In this sense, Bapanas remains animated by the goals that Scott cast as those of trying to see like a state. A half hour walk away, north across the Chilliwung River and into the busy commercial heart of Jakarta, surrounding the Thamrin roundabout, one finds Pulse Lab Jakarta. Pulse Lab Jakarta is one of the three labs created to carry out an initiative of the United Nations Secretary General called UN Global Pulse. The goal of this initiative is to conduct research and development towards the prospect of harnessing data science to understand changes in human well-being in real time, to discern, quote, digital distress signals that forewarn of socioeconomic crises, and to drive the adoption of new approaches to decision making that make use of these signals across the public sector. Pulse Lab Jakarta opened in 2012 as a joint project of the Government of Indonesia and the United Nations, and other labs are operating in Kampala and in New York under slightly different arrangements. The building in which the lab is located is a contemporary glass tower. The lab itself is light and open with crisp blue and white signage. Its shared spaces feature fake grass, a swing chair, bean bags, workplace scribbles on glass walls, whiteboards, and windows. Its staff are mostly on the younger side and dressed in business casual attire. Again, some women wear the veil and some do not. The atmosphere is focused yet unhurried throughout its air-conditioned offices. It has the air of a well-funded startup. When I was there in mid-2015, lab staff members were preparing for a hackathon, hashtag HackGov, bringing together programmers, designers and social planners from different parts of Indonesia. They were also getting ready to provide training to Bappenas on big data analytics for development and humanitarian action. Projects underway or completed recently at Pulse Lab Jakarta at that time included a project to combine and make available to local government decision makers in a structured and user-friendly way data from two existing citizen feedback and complaint mechanisms online, plus analysis of social media, indicating citizen sentiment on a wide range of local issues, such as electric power outages. The lab had been exploring the potential to mine social media during forest fire and peat fire haze events to support emergency response management. And also in progress was a project exploring whether Twitter data could be used to nowcast real-time food prices and food price shocks as a proxy for food price statistics. There was discussion too about the possibility of using drones and automated analysis of aerial imagery to monitor and report on the use of development funding at the village level. Now, despite the differences in physical surrounds, conversations that I had within Bappenas about the work ongoing at Pulse Lab Jakarta revealed an enduring preoccupation, even in the latter context, with making the populace legible for governance purposes. Interviewees spoke of the importance of, quote, getting a big picture and gaining more sophisticated tools to do planning through Pulse Lab Jakarta, including planning, quote, what kind of social protection scheme or program or activities Bappenas could prepare, end quote. Interviewees within Pulse Lab Jakarta spoke of the Indonesian government's various levels, voracious appetite for data and their desire for statewide visibility. They just tell you they want to see everything, remarked one interviewee. The district level wants more data, and the province level wants more data, so everyone has their data that they want to collect, noted another. And seeing everything demands reduction, simplification, visualization. It requires, in other words, maps. Bappenas and others within the Indonesian government were said to want data mapping to see the gaps in the data. A live dashboard that would be really useful for the government, one interviewee noted. The organising aspirations of which James Scott wrote are, in short, still in evidence in and around Pulse Lab Jakarta. But the data and the analytical and constitutive techniques with which the state and the UN are working in this instance have changed quite dramatically since Scott's late 1990s analysis. The data being mined by Pulse Lab Jakarta, working with Bappenas and other Indonesian government collaborators, combines active and passive, state and non-state, not-for-profit and commercial sources and streams. Some of these, such as data flowing through the existing online complaint mechanisms, are intentionally directed data streams aimed at government, while others are gleaned from unstructured textual, visual and geographic data drawn from missives shared with followers and friends or generated otherwise, without any explicit appeal for government action or expectation of government recording. The differing terms and agreements under which access to these each of these different kinds of data is afforded means that their synoptic integration on the national or global plane is often practically impeded. And the process of making these data legible is a process that is no longer principally a matter for the state and international institutions concerned. This is apparent in the case of Twitter data, for instance, of which Pulse Lab Jakarta is making particularly frequent use, thanks to its negotiated access to the Twitter fire hose and to Indonesians, Jakartans in particular, being unusually active in this media. Even with access to every publicly available tweet published during a specified period, Twitter data take the form that they do, thanks in large part to Twitter's proprietary search, recommendation, and trending algorithms, character limits and geotagging, retweet and like functions. It is only in dialogue with these curation techniques and parameters that Indonesian citizens express the sentiments that PulseLab Jakarta uses further commercial software, that is Crimson Hexagon software, to try to mine. It is only through the distinctive lens that these features create that Indonesians experience the public in which they see themselves as taking part and are in turn set up as weather vanes of public sentiment. It no longer seems accurate to characterise the state as the architect and overseer of these particular projects of simplification and legibility, nor perhaps even to characterise them as such at all. Twitter's 140 character limit might suggest simplicity and legibility, but the volume and character of the unstructured data that flow through the Twitter firehose and the range of techniques that may be used to analyse and represent those data suggest otherwise. So seeing like a state is not, in the case of the Indonesian government's involvement in PulseLab Jakarta, what it once was. In seeking to make use of unstructured digital data in immense volumes from a diversity of sources, passed through a range of proprietary filters and metrics, the state no longer aspires to make its own maps or direct its own monocular gaze from on high. Heroic simplification and rational ordering no longer seem so much like the end goals. Rather, a succession of rapid-fire snapshots resulting from automated dives into vast and shifting oceans of data, this seems to be what the state and many international institutions seek to sate their appetite for contact with the real. As one of my interviewees put it, speaking of the PulseLab Jakarta's contribution, we're not saying you should do away with any of their traditional approach, but perhaps it creates a better early warning system, particularly for Bapanas, so that they're getting a better idea of what's happening on the ground at the moment. Modes of analysis, too, have changed. No longer are comprehensive evaluations, fully developed costings, or far-reaching forecasts regarded as preconditions for action. Governance practice is perhaps being informed by methodologies of product and business development that prefer minimally viable prototypes over well-marinated plans. States and international institutions continue to plan, of course, but alongside this, they are increasingly inclined to generate testable policy mock-ups informed by provisional hypotheses and to seek rapid user evaluation of these mock-ups. As one of my interviewees explained, speaking of PulseLab Jakarta, our whole premise is that we will come up with proof of concepts and prototypes that can be handed over to agencies, to development donor programs, to the government, to be scaled up. These prototypes, another interviewee stressed, will not offer a universal solution for everything. And PulseLab Jakarta is, I was told, constantly changing course throughout the project to make sure that what it's doing is in line with what the experts know. Yet another pair of interviewees familiar with PulseLab Jakarta's work emphasise the importance of soliciting feedback early and widely in this process. Quote, we're getting input from a lot of very, very good sort of community level and Jakarta-based NGOs, research institutions and the rest. So it's a big pot of sort of synthesising. End quote. There is something in this big pot of new governance experimentalism, that may be a term that may be familiar to some of you. That is the commitment to governance through collaborative experiment and stakeholder engagement promoted in the work of legal scholars such as Charles Sable, Gráinne de Berker and Orly Lobel. The influence of new governance experimentalism is, as you know, apparent in the work and organisation of many democratic governments, including the work of the Behavioural Insights Team, or Nudge Unit, introduced to the British government by former Prime Minister David Cameron. There are, however, some noteworthy differences between the governance sensibility that I'm describing and new governance experimentalism. The project of PulseLab Jakarta is not one of institutional redesign. nor does it foster comparative benchmarking across different prototypes or the introduction of particular kinds of regulatory relationships. It is not seeking to engender a wider scale problem-solving and negotiating praxis for maximal efficiency and democratic legitimacy. The approach that I'm describing focuses rather on technical optimization towards a more frictionless existence. Its orientation is around the figure of the user or recipient of goods and services, and around practices of need detection, need making, and need satisfaction. It encourages the tackling of tasks within the limits of a defined data set or an array of interlocking data sets in ways suggested by those data. It envisions possibilities being worked up iteratively and inductively from the inferences that may be drawn from the data available, as limited as those data may be, rather than through cross-sectoral information sharing and learning. The outlook for which I'm using Pulse Lab Jakarta as a shorthand is not concerned with persuading individuals to voluntarily place themselves into mutually beneficial social relations, which Amy Cohen has rightly, I think, characterised as the Tocquevillian imperative underpinning new governance literature. It aims to lead people along new socio-technical pathways through incremental adoption and repetitive use, rather than through reasoned persuasion or nudging. It seeks to make things and create processes that are better than existing things and processes only to the extent that they may become routine or technically indispensable, or that they make other things and processes seem obsolete. As a mode of subject production, its main output is less the neoliberal self-governor and risk manager, or the citizen problem solver of new governance literature, although they still feature very prominently on the terrain that I'm describing. Rather, the archetypal subjects called up by and enrolled in the work of Pulse Lab Jakarta are the backyard tinkerers, DIY labourers, or pseudonymised producers of the so-called maker movement, a term used to describe subcultural practices of production in which unused or discarded materials, technologies, and software are reassembled and repurposed into new products. It is especially as generators and users of data that these tinkering every persons become vectors of governance in the development setting which I have depicted. It is the circulation of data in, from, and around these figures and their curation of and appearance in data that authorises states and international institutions' governance and development operations in the mode I'm describing. It is the remote detection of these subjects' ascribed needs, rather than any confluence of wills, claims, grievances, or plans, that is seen to underwrite the distribution or withholding of resources to or from them. No longer does Hirschman's famous dilemma of exit, that is withdrawing from the relationship, voice, that is expressing a grievance and seeking to have it redressed, or loyalty, seem to present itself to the consumer of development aid, although one might wonder if these have ever been options for recipients of development aid. No longer does the imperative of public participation for legitimacy's sake seem paramount. When one's conditions and needs are inferred from computerised sentiment analysis of Twitter or automated processing of satellite or aerial images, what could these terms possibly mean? As well as evoking the diffuse productivity of the maker movement, the governance language and sensibility that I've been describing are, I think, strongly identifiable with a business methodology known as the lean startup. This was popularised by the young American entrepreneur, blogger, author and venture analyst Eric Ries, and is now well entrenched in the pedagogy of Harvard Business School and many other places. It may be that my informants have no actual familiarity with this methodology or with Ries's writings, but the lean startup is nonetheless a helpful encapsulation of the change in approach on which I'm trying to put a finger. Never prone to understatement, the Harvard Business Review announced in 2013 that the lean startup methodology, quote, changes everything. In brief, A lean startup approach favours experimentation over elaborate planning, customer feedback over intuition, and iterative design over traditional big design upfront development. End quote. Rather than elaborate a fully defensible business plan and build a business around that, the lean startup model encourages entrepreneurs to launch a bare bones product or concept as quickly as possible. This will be what in lean startup parlance is known as the minimally viable product. Something developed only to a point sufficient to allow useful feedback to be garnered from early adopters. The mission of the startup will then be to refine that product and grow a business around it incrementally in light of user feedback. The lean startup retains always the flexibility to pivot to a new direction in thinking or practice in response to customer input. Although advanced as a business concept, Eric Ries defines the lean startup in a way clearly intended for broader application. A startup is, Ries says, any human institution designed to create a new product or service under conditions of extreme uncertainty. You can hear echoes of the lean startup approach in the following remarks of one of my Jakarta-based informants, talking about the creation of new applications to address development needs. You can kind of go about managing that in two ways, he said. You can kind of say, well, everything's going to be subject to a new ordering principle, and that principle will be some new software. Or you can just kind of fertilize everything, rather than just keep making a bunch of large things that don't work. So the basis of our approach is incrementality, he continued, that you only build the increments that you know aren't being built, and you try to optimize all of the things which can interact with that increment, and that you never build ahead. Another interviewee described some of Pulse Lab Jakarta's work in similar terms. We've come up with tools, data assets, mapping. We've just created them, so we've kind of just put them out there into the Twitter sphere and asked people for comments. And I think this will really define where we go from here. If I'm right that the walk from Bappenas to Pulse Lab Jakarta marks some movement towards new decision-making and policy-making approach in humanitarian and development work, towards an approach of which the lean startup method is somewhat representative, then what should we make of this? Is this a good thing or a bad thing? My aim in this talk is not to evaluate this shift in any comprehensive, definitive way. Some ramifications may be positive, others less so. Aspects of this change will serve some well, while leaving others worse off. What I am aiming to do here this evening is identify some difficulties that this change in approach may pose for scholars and practitioners of international law, law and development, and others invested in trying not to replicate the development catastrophes of the past, in particular contemporary instances. I've singled out an anthropologist, James C. Scott, as one who has sounded influential warnings about disastrous development endeavours of the 20th century and their enduring legacies in development thought and practice. But legal scholars have long been at the forefront of critique of this kind. Some of you may have read David Trubrick's and Mark Gallanter's powerful 1974 article, Scholars in Self-Estrangement. In that article, Trubrick and Gallanter grappled with law and development researchers' growing awareness that the development and technical assistance projects that they'd been helping to design and implement may not have contributed to greater freedom or equality, enhanced participation, or the realization of any shared rationality among those that they were designed to help. In working through these worries, Trubeck and Gallanter alighted on an approach they called eclectic critique. According to them, this was an exaggeration or full development of the critical perspective that treated as inherently problematic assumptions that law is both potent and good. Also problematic, according to this approach, was any assumption that law possesses a scientific character that makes it trustworthy as a bearer of certain outcomes or as a carrier of certain institutional and moral properties that naturally cohere. In place of these assumptions, eclectic critique exhibited, quote, a roving suspicion of both first world and third world government policies as vehicles of either development or legality, which should command the loyalties of scholars, end quote. Assumptions of moral worth became questions to apply reflexively to effects of law and development activity, including law and development scholarship. Manifestations of this critical circumspection about and reflection on law and development projects' effects have taken many, many forms. In Scott's book, Seeing Like a State, a case was made for the indispensable role and abiding potency of practical knowledge, informal processes, and improvisation in the face of unpredictability. Scott raised the alarm about perennial bureaucratic and market-driven inattention to these factors through resolute singularity of outlook. And he diagnosed this inattention as key to the failure of many of the 20th century's most ambitious development programs. These have been recurring themes in many exercises in eclectic critique by which the development project has been dogged, but also energised since the late 20th century. That is, the embrace of localism, practical know-how, historical specificity, and grassroots productivity as key to unlocking and overturning recurring dynamics of error, domination, and hubris. Those who have taken on board this past few decades' work of this kind are now engaged in a wide range of projects in law and development research, some solution-generating and some more radically framed. Many of these projects entail disentanglement and distinction, much like the task of distinction in which I've just engaged in separating out these archetypes of Bapanas and Pulse Lab Jakarta. A top-down approach is often distinguished from a bottom-up approach, with preferences typically classed in favour of the bottom-up. A hegemonic, disciplinary or extractive logic is often set up against a counter-hegemonic history of practice. Again, in progressive circles, the normative scales are usually weighted towards the counter-hegemonic. Sovereign claims are opposed to defence of the commons, orthodoxies are juxtaposed to heterodoxies, and so on and so forth. Now, the difficulty for work of this kind posed by the move from Bapanas to Pulse Lab Jakarta in development practice is that these guiding and galvanising oppositions are now much harder to draw and maintain. Which of the two is more bottom-up? Bapanas, with its long-standing commitment to sub-district level community-driven development promotion? Or Pulse Lab Jakarta, with its efforts to empower communities by trialling innovative new tools to foster real-time responsiveness? In what sense exactly are the methodologies with which Pulse Lab Jakarta and through its partnership with that lab, Bapanas, are experimenting hegemonic when they are designed to be endlessly answerable to user feedback? Now, it would seem naive to suggest that the complicities with which Trubeck and Gallanter drew attention in the mid-1970s or the blind spots of which Scott wrote in the late 1990s have simply disappeared, and I don't think they have. But what exactly are the trade-offs that a commitment to iterative innovation demands? And where are the Faustian bargains being newly struck in this context? And what should we make of the fact that those marginalised bearers of practical intelligence that Scott championed as key to doing development better in the future, they now seem more or less central to the development enterprise without much apparent change in its politics or material effects? Perhaps we might start with where not to look to locate and confront some pivotal trade-offs and bargains being struck in the settings that I've described. Overall institutional design seems to be less significant as an indicator of bias or value than it might once have been. It seems, for example, less apt to condemn something for being excessively centralised or to celebrate the decentralised when more or less everything is prone to being cast as a start-up operation. The tradition of analysing and unveiling hierarchical power relations embedded in systems of social knowledge, this tradition or aspects of it also does not seem quite fit for purpose. To focus critical attention on enduring properties of epistemological architecture seems to miss the point that architecting, that rather ugly term used for the design and configuration of computer systems, programs and applications, is ongoing in most institutional settings in which development and humanitarian work are underway. It seems to miss the point, too, that this architecting activity will load those settings with all sorts of known and unknown priorities and exclusions, some of which will be extremely difficult to unearth, decode, and communicate in systemic terms. Where the architecting in question deploys machine learning in particular, that is where it involves computer algorithms that continually adapt to or learn from the interaction with data, these priorities, hierarchies and exclusions may be near impossible to disclose in advance or recreate after the fact. Knowing where and how to look is hard also because of the rapid redundancy built into this way of working. If you're building and trying out many mock-ups of decision-making tools and generating on this basis any number of provisional policies, then some proportion of these will go nowhere, a significant proportion. Policy junk and surplus technology are inevitable byproducts of this style of governance. There is, as one of my interviewees highlighted, still the problem of building a bunch of things that don't work, even if the things in question aren't as big or elaborate as they might once have been. So if the public, researchers, or any other interested constituency wishes to engage with this kind of development practice and try to understand its ramifications and counter its bad effects in particular instances, it can be difficult to identify the particular applications and artifacts with which they need to become familiar. Much like the donors and funders concerned, the public must try to pick winners or foresee which of the prototypes in circulation is likely to be scaled up over time. Is automated text mining of Twitter for citizen sentiment really likely to be a significant factor in forming governance in Indonesia and elsewhere? What about the early warnings about socioeconomic well-being that mobile phone top-up data are meant to yield? And what about the whole premise of lean startup thinking? Is that likely to be around in 5 years' time? Even if it were clear exactly where resistant, critical, or reformist attention should be directed, the difficulty arises that I've already mentioned, that many of the standard elements in the repertoire of the critical or progressive legal scholar may not be fit for purpose. Consider the tool of historicisation. This latest fixation on accessing and utilising real-time information for development has a history. It is an outgrowth of the high modernist development ideology of which Scott wrote. The work of scholars such as historian Theodore Porter on faith in numbers and quantitative modelling, and political theorist Timothy Mitchell on colonial era technopolitics, and many others, sheds light on where UN Global Pulse came from. And yet there's something so resolutely ahistorical, so insistently presentist about the work of Pulse Lab Jakarta, for example, that historical critique seems likely to fall flat in this context, to seem beside the point. Many have mocked Wired editor Chris Anderson's 2008 claim that the advent of big data marks the end of theory and makes the scientific method obsolete, and probably rightly so. And yet discontinuities are as important to note as continuities. The temporality of economic and social change and the aesthetics and claims of development work have shifted in quite radical ways. The nature and expectations of its archetypal subjects have altered, as I've earlier described. Critique poorly attuned to these shifts seems unlikely to find its mark. Speaking of the aesthetics of development work, it seems important to raise also the challenges posed by diffusion and profusion. The aesthetic of the recent development practices that I've introduced in talking about Pulse Lab Jakarta is an aesthetic of openness. Open source, open data, user feedback, these are among its buzzwords. But if everything is open, or relatively more so, then points of possible strategic or critical intervention become harder to identify, precisely because there are so many such points from which one might choose. Where exactly is the locus of most significant action in this emergent mix? Is it in the architecture of the analytical software deployed? Is it in the particular implementation of that software in one or other instance? Was it in the meeting room on the day on which the Indonesian government and the UN agreed to co-sponsor Pulse Lab Jakarta? Or was it on those series of historical interactions and that changing culture of work that led the UN Secretary General to alight upon the idea of the UN taking the global community's digital pulse some years earlier? Or is the most significant action yet to take place as we observe the scaling up of some or other of these initiatives and the distribution of scarce resources to communities in need and the withholding from others on the strengths of these. How might the communities in question, those whose needs are met and those whose needs are not, take account of these decisions and the processes by which they were made? What might yet be made of these latest versions of hybrid knowledge making for development ends, combining expert and non-expert, human and non-human agents and insights? There are just so many possible pressure points and so many components in what my informants like to call this emergent information ecosystem. It is for this reason that I think there is still much to be gained from the kinds of overall stylistic assessment that James C. Scott provided, and others have provided as well. Scott's critique of modernist calculation and design has very limited purchase on the practices that I've just described. In my view, high modernist ambition is no longer characteristic of development and humanitarian work, or no longer principally so. But the example that Scott set is still useful insofar as he tried to capture and probe the effects of a sensibility or style widely reproduced in the details of development work. What was important also about Scott seeing like a state book, and has been important about the work of scholars such as Trubeck and Gallanter and others, is that these scholars were not content to tinker around the edges of the fundamental dilemmas that they described. Better data here, wider participation there, a dash of accountability scattered throughout. These were not the kind of solutions that they entertained. Rather, they insisted on keeping their readers immersed in the predicaments to which they drew attention. The difficulty for readers of their work now is that the ways of navigating those predicaments that they suggested, James Scott's recommendations in particular, now offer relatively little guidance. When Scott suggested that those engaged in development policy and practice pay more attention to informal innovation and take small reversible steps rather than large ones, he seems to be reaffirming rather than proposing any alternative to the way that states now aspire to see and to govern. What might once have seemed like quite a radical project now reads like a project of minimalist optimization. Now there are, of course, just in case you think I'm a misanthrope, there are, of course, not just predicaments and pitfalls in the shift I have described. There are also possibilities. There is probably great potential in the development of humanitarian sectors turned to data science. But there is nonetheless the ongoing prospect of that work bringing about violence and wastage. The work of Scott and others have shown again and again how devastating can be the hubris of the innovator and the myopia of the well-intentioned. Scholars and practitioners concerned about maximising that possible potential and minimising that possible violence and wastage need to do more than fertilise everything across this ecosystem, as one of my interviewees suggested doing. They also need to do something other than bet on one or other of the locations that I've walked you through this evening. This is not a story with an either-or ending. Neither Bapunas's approach nor that of Pulse Lab Jakarta, as I've styled them, promises to keep at bay the risks of the development endeavour that many others before me have highlighted. Instead of championing one or other of these approaches, legal scholars must devise new ways of loading questions into prevailing truisms, including the truisms of a lean startup mentality, and thereby give pause to the ceaseless churn of contemporary governance practice. So rather than end in either one of the locations to which I've taken you this evening, the humid hullabaloo of Bapunas or the cool glass-walled confidence of Pulse Lab Jakarta, let us end metaphorically amid the circular mayhem of an intersection that lies between them, the Thamrin roundabout. And I think my foot is not correct if any Bahasa speakers in the room, but bear with me. There are times when this roundabout is empty, occasions such as the car-free day held every Sunday in central Jakarta. But most of the time, it is abuzz with Jakarta's infamous traffic, a constant noisy stream of minibuses, trucks, motorbikes, cars, and the odd, brave pedestrian. Those who wish to navigate this intersection must get in amongst this traffic, jostling and jockeying to find a way through it, usually in unspoken collaboration or contention with others making similar attempts. Redesigning this intersection or rerouting this traffic does not seem like a realistic prospect for those so engaged, at least not in the near term. So for those who have to get through it on a daily basis, questions of design or structural reform may be irrelevant. What matters are the navigational techniques and practical styles that they pick up en route as they observe and learn from the different ways that people engage tactically with the ceaseless churn of traffic. James Scott recommended that the state expand its gaze, especially by looking down to the ground. I'm suggesting that we focus somewhat less on trying to redirect or augment the state's or international institutions' lines of sight, and more on understanding and grappling with the ways in which they now try to see. One cannot engage with contemporary governance practices surrounding the development project or with the changes in these that I've described by proclaiming oneself the finder of some better destination, or by positioning oneself at a distance to them. To do so would risk repeating the errors of the past. Whether as a scholar or as a practitioner of law and development, international law or global governance, one cannot assume a posture of critical sanctimony or lay claim to being uncompromised or beyond complicity. Neither immersion in history nor investment in futurist innovation promises such a way out. Instead, it is down in the detail of particular practices in the midst of mundane socio-technical work, including scholarly work, that developmental futures are being made and remade. It is by observing and engaging assembly line personnel, people such as the staff and Bapanas and Pulse Lab Jakarta, and understanding what they're doing and how, that we come to understand how we are seeing now and what new blind spots we are cultivating and with what effects. This evening, I've spoken in particular about a lean startup version of seeing like a state and some of the things that such an approach may make harder to do or to know. This is just one aspect of the now that seems to be taking hold in the work of development and humanitarian agencies. There's no elsewhere to this particular now. There's nowhere else that we can hope to go, at least not immediately. But there could potentially be an otherwise or any number of otherwises folded within it. Turning the development project on itself, making it simple and legible on more or less its own terms as it appears now, is a vital first stage in teasing out what those otherwises could be. Doing so makes apparent that it is in the politics of prototypical technique rather than in the politics of the master plan or normative principle that the fates of those caught up in the development project are being and will yet be decided. Thank you. I look forward to our discussion.
Thank you so much, Fleur, for cutting through the ceaseless churn of contemporary data governance with the ease of a butter knife. Stuart, Martha,
yes,
will respond.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Stephen, for inviting me, and also Fleur. It's fantastic to be in conversation with you again. As I was preparing for today, I pulled out an old volume of the Journal of Law and Society, which I had edited a special issue of back in 2007, and Fleur contributed an article to that on corporate power and the deal. And as I was flicking through, I saw that one of the subtitles was indeed Empire of the Deal. And as I reflect on what Donald Trump is up to these days and the sort of power of the deal that he seems to be deploying in his rhetoric of governance, I thought you're a scarily prescient scholar. And now when I read about lean startups as a presence with possibly no elsewhere, or the no elsewhere to this now, I'm also extremely frightened, I think, from this description. So I suppose my what orients my response is a set of questions about what is the normative implications of your anthropological gaze on these institutions. So to start with, I think it's really significant and important to be focusing on what I would characterize as visive power, taking a phrase from Peter Goodrich, the power of the state to see, or to take the to use the phrase that you draw from James Scott, the ways a state sees various activities through a census or through maps and so on and so forth. And this, of course, is a long-standing characteristic of state power and sovereign power. In fact, it's a lovely image that came to mind when I was reading the paper that Derrida describes in one of his final seminars of Louis XIV having an elephant brought before him, because this is the mighty king that wanted to see into absolutely everything. And this elephant was brought before, a dead elephant was brought before Louis XIV and was then dissected so that the monarch could see into absolutely every creature, including this mighty, elephant. So what you describe in the paper is what I would sort of characterize as a move from the tropical state. You spoke of the humid hullabaloo of Bapanas, a move from the tropical state to a plastic state. And having spent most of my childhood in Sri Lanka, the sort of mid-century architecture, the work of planning commissions, the sort of Nehruvian state basically came to mind when you were describing Bapanas. And so there is an important colonial and post-colonial history to institutions such as Bapanas that I didn't see in the paper, and I thought I wondered whether you would sort of comment on that. What we see in the sort of the description of the tropical or planning state, you know, is one that is engaged with villages in terms of small funding grants, but also has a national vision, is oriented by the possibility of the formation of a social consensus. And the move you're describing with the emergence of the more plastic, you know, the glass building with fake glass, and the work of Pulse Lab, which is, you know, harvesting Twitter data to basically create, to make contact with the real, I think is the phrase you use. That how do we, should we be indeed, or are you equating this, equating the way in which sentiment is captured by Pulse Lab with the sort of vision of the state that, let's say, the Nehruvian state had? So that sense of needing to set goals and targets for development. And I found myself, in a sense, being a somewhat sort of nostalgic high modernist creature in terms of planning and development, because the sense I got from your descriptions of Pulse Lab was of a kind of ground pulled from beneath our feet. That this is so, the work is so, their work is so amorphous that we can't really hold on to any kind of planning vision. And so the sort of development experiences, albeit with the sort of neoliberal twists in the post-colonial world, are also ones of success, of, you know, where you can count the numbers of houses that have moved from being mud houses to brick houses, the number of toilets that are being built inside homes as opposed to being outside homes, and so on and so forth. So that sort of sense of the Nehruvian development state, which I think is very influential from the 1950s and 60s onwards, didn't resonate in the analysis. The sort of the other thing I wanted to maybe comment on was, I think it's been a consistent part of your work to look at sensibility and style. So sort of the way in which an anthropologist creates a kind of affective response to your own affective responses when you encounter subjects or institutions or architecture. So for instance, the way in which there's a sort of neutralization, if you like, of who you encounter. So there are some women who are wearing a veil and some not, both in the Bapanas building and Pulse Lab. But of course, we know, you know, that veiling and the attire of women, and indeed Islam and the modern state, are not in any way sort of neutral phenomena in the current global climate, or indeed in the kind of emergence of these post-colonial states. So how does sensibility and style and what you encounter as a sort of legal anthropologist in these settings, how does that sort of feed into the analysis that you make of what you encounter? And then finally, because I'm sure lots of people have their own sort of comments to make, I guess I want to sort of close with a different Scott, so David Scott rather than James Scott, and I'm certainly personally very influenced by his work, and in his last book, Omens of Adversity, he talks about how we should be really cautious about end times, the sort of the way in which a discourse of crisis can very quickly lead us to thinking about time and political formations and techniques of governance as end times. And of course, the end of the Cold War, which he's writing about in Omens of Adversity, and the revolution in Granada, is the example he talks about. And I wondered about the way you're working with time, how you're working with time when you're moving between Bapanas and Pulse Lab. And I think, you know, you put this most sharply at the end of your paper, where you say there seems to be no elsewhere but the now. And I guess I would draw from a more sort of Walter Benjamin approach to this, and try to look at the present as a time and place in which the past is still present. And that part of what, and I think part of this is what sort of, this was really Benjamin's methodology, was to ask the question of how, through various dialectical images that he constructed and assembled as montage, which is in a sense what you're doing, there's a sort of montage technique here as well, that we can see both the past and the present here now. So it is not that there's no elsewhere to this now. Indeed, it is elsewheres that are being made present, you know, through the kinds of priorities that are being deployed through, you know, the lean startup type, the lean startup type model. So I think I'll leave it there. Thanks.
So since Stuart has directed a number of questions to you, do you want to respond to those,
okay,
or will I open it up? Perhaps
maybe, and then
other people can think about questions you might have while Fleur is responding, and we can move to the floor to Tweed. I'll turn this off behind us.
So there's a lot here to ruminate. As always, Stuart has arrived bearing gifts, and they always are weighty gifts that you have to take away and open several times. So I'll do that. But let me just respond briefly to a couple of the points. And I think I'll start with the end and work backwards. And I might not get to the start, actually, but I'll... So this last point. So what I'm doing here is emphasising a need to cleave very closely and think from and with a set of practices that I'm positioning in the now. But of course, the whole point of the story of this collaboration between Bapanas and Pulse Lab Jakarta is to focus on exactly this. So even though I say, I sort of emphasise that one of the characteristics of the sensibility is its refusal of continuities and its focus on discontinuities, it is interesting to me that Bapanas is a 50-50 partner in this exercise, and that the end goal of this startup is take up by Bapanas. It is in many ways exactly the exercise that you're describing and associating with Benjamin, and that's, you know, absolutely. So I think I need to figure out how, because I'm skirting quite a fine line. I want to think from and emphasize the distinctiveness of this and try and sharpen a sense of a shift, and to do that emphasize the discontinuity and the limited capacity to carry our usual routines, and that I think there is that it would be productive to try and imagine oneself as occupying a present. But this is absolutely a story of the continuities of that Bapanas exercise and expertise into this. So what I and also the failures of the startup exercise, all the policy junk and surplus technology, that they fail to get taken up. So that what is one of the reasons why this particular site is so interesting to me, because it does allow this sense of the present bearing and being and still being, you know, that this churn is very much still occupied by history and by the aspirations and institutions that we identify with another time. So this is not a story of end times, but I'm interested in if we do, because I feel as though a lot of work in international law is concerned or is focusing more on the continuity, and I'm interested in the limits of that. And but I mean, when you were talking about the elsewhere's already present, and recalling Benjamin's technique of the montage, this is absolutely what's in the paper. And this is what I'm talking about when I talk about the otherwise is folded within it. So I think it's maybe a matter of emphasis. And the anthropological technique and the neutralization, yeah, it's an interesting dilemma, obviously. And I always think of it as more as bracketing than neutralization. So it's a bracketing I tell the story of the fact that some of these stuff are veiled in both sides, because I'm kind of bracketing what is the most charged issue in Indonesian contemporary daily life at the moment, which is around religious conflict. I mean, all these blasphemy trials. So I'm saying that's absolutely there, and they're wrestling with that, but that's not sort of in the foreground for purposes of what I'm trying to put my finger on. So it's a bracketing rather than neutralization. So again, in the writing, maybe it's, there's a sort of, so then the nostalgia for the Nauruvian state, and whether I'm shortchanging its successes. I mean, the emphasis I placed upon the Kecamatan project and how incredible, really groundbreaking it was an attempt to kind of recognise that. And that's one of the reasons why I think the UN decided to do this with Bapanas. They're seen as a successful, powerful, you know, very astute development planning agency. They are the best of those, you know, they're really impressive at what they do. So again, it's not really a story of replacement as much as these are the best at what they do, and yet this is what they're focusing a lot of their time on. And that's interesting, and I'm trying to understand what what that could mean in particular instances, really not by way of saying in some wholesale way that we can evaluate the normative implications of this shift in a wholesale sense, but suggesting where we might look to go about that in particular instances, particular instances of scaling. So at the moment where the project is being scaled up, because even though I said it's hard to tell, there are lots of indications. It doesn't happen instantaneously, obviously. So in the process of scaling up particular instantiations, my sense, my hunch is that this, that thinking and grasping what is distinctive to this governance style, what is distinctive, what is different, as well as what is continuous, is really important to the process that one might engage in of thinking, well, where's this, what bad effects might this have? And engaging in that kind of evaluation. I love the dead elephant. I'll have to.
Wonderful. Just my own immediate observation. I haven't read James Scott's book in quite a long time, but in a way, from a current vantage point, responding to your talk, the problem he's identifying for the state is a formatting problem.
Yeah.
In a way, we want to read and we want to simplify, but we don't have a matrix within which we can fit all the pieces together. Partly what you're showing is the continuity, the banal continuity that we must return to, is that that format is now here.
Mm.
And so where at the time the state appeared like a node in a matrix that we thought might have been an international law matrix, today it's a node in a data matrix of some sort. Okay. We've quite a lot of questions. Great. I don't know your name.
Yeah, thank you. Hi, sorry. I'm Emily Andrews. I'm not an LSE press actually. I'm from the Institute for...
We do have a microphone. Do we need it? Or can people hear properly?
Yeah, that's what
wonderful.
Right, thank you very much for your talk. So I imagine that you're aware that this kind of lean mindset approach is very explicitly been ported into UK government policy and activity and in Australia as well. And so, and that's the arena that I'm knowledgeable about, so that's where this comes from. And so I'm interested in this tension where you're saying, you know, how you're positing this tension between BAPNAS and policy lab, whatever it was called, that wasn't it, but how far BAPNAS will actually accept this. So my question is around actually how far really into kind of governance practices is this lean mindset going to go? So my specific example would be in the UK tax administration. There is a large number of people now have been brought into our kind of tax, into HMRC to kind of work in this way. But of course, the reason, and it happened under a Conservative government because it is going to save money, right? The idea is that you don't fail slowly, you fail really fast, so you don't waste tons of money, just waste a little bit of money getting it wrong quickly. So the idea is also developing through kind of a lot of real-time exchange of data, and we see the same thing in our new benefits administration. Universal credit works on the same idea that we can, you know, gather a lot of data and be very reactive to people's circumstances. But actually, up to a certain point, it fails because you will never iteratively develop tax policy. Or if I suppose that's my question, like, will you? You know, ultimately, if you keep user researching how do you administer tax, you might come up with universal basic income. And that's not necessarily the political reality that kind of is being asked for. So how far actually do you think this lean mindset is going to go?
Yes, why not? Yako, and then perhaps...
Or is that too... Or is that... I guess it's... I should maybe answer it, but... Yeah.
Collected.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, well, thanks.
So it's a... Thank you very much. It was a quick question, just for clarification. I think that when you were talking about how sort of... I might not get the vocabulary right, but when sort of the local population or the affected population, when they were, that it might be unclear for them where agency could be exercised, right? Whether to put pressure on the initial stages of when the president was deciding to participate in this, or in which algorithm might be employed, or then at the stage of the take-up. But then I think your closing passage was that you said that these futures will be decided in the politics of these prototypes. So I'm wondering whether you've made a choice or whether that's still open.
Okay, should we take one more? Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yes, my question is because I'm developing a startup on the concept of data, big data, machine learning applied in development, sustainable development. And the question I'm asking to you is, okay, I accept all the approach from planning to prototype, but what is missing, I think maybe you can clarify, prototype, but strategically. Now, I'm involved with European Union, and they have developed this smart strategy specialization. What I'm, let's say, trying to identify is to divide the innovation into the smart strategy specialization, how to link this, let's say, niche or innovation into the strategy, because it's there where the sustainability comes. Not even UK government just announced this industrial strategy. And what they start to do right now, I think they develop they are bringing the concept of Europe. Okay, now there is a Brexit. They don't call it anymore smart strategy specialization, but they call smart strategy. And what they want to plan is how you can, let's say, plan a strategy using data in industrial sector. This is the aim. That's why they are collecting for all UK data and try to develop an hub. There is already a hub. That's why I would like to understand where you fit the strategical approach. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I take those? Yeah. Okay. Great questions. Thank you so much. Emily, yeah, absolutely. And sandboxes, and there's a lot of this around. The question, I mean, to the question of how far this will go, I don't know, really. No. But I do think I do think that one of the aspects of this is that policy is actually being generated iteratively, because each of these little exercises, prototypes, applications carries with it. If you line them all up, they actually have different policy assumptions and different kind of hunches built into them about. And really, you could, if you were writing a policy from each one, the policies would not line up. So there is a sense that the policy will be kind of worked out through the process of user adoption of a particular application. So, I mean, I don't think that's the same as the way Australian and the British governments are going about it, or even some of the big commercial banks are going about these. So. That's what's interesting to me, because of course, once you start putting on glasses, you see everything through your own little funny glasses. Because then I was thinking, maybe that's what Trump is up to. Maybe he's prototyping policy. You know, he's kind of just throwing things and seeing what sticks. You know, an obsessive, feedback. But yeah, I mean, I'm not making a claim to be diagnosing what's going on there. So I think, and given the investment and the prevalence and the strange articulation of a number of different sites of significant investment, even though the money is not so great in each instance, the collective investment in these kinds of style of governance practice is massive. My hunch is it's going to be around for a while. So it's not. I don't think it's a flash in the pan. There's frustrations in this instance that are not so evident in their other lab, where I'm yet to do field work. But from what I can tell, Kampala, there's much higher take-up for a range of reasons. So one of the interesting things as I go through this project, which I'm really, is to figure out what's going on there, what's the difference in these, because this is a site of a lot of frustration and tension. But in terms of how far the penetration, you know, who knows? But I don't think it's just, I mean, in my own question of is it going to be around in 5 years? Yeah, I think it is. I think these sort of styles take a while to get hot. You know, it's taken a while to get going, and they stick around, you know, and they become overlaid with other. I guess I'm not very good at prediction. The question, really great question about whether I've made a choice. So I think that you can approach the different sites I identify and other relevant sites from this idea of kind of immersion. So what I'm saying at the end when I'm talking about the politics of prototypical technique, I think there's something you could engage in that kind of level of analysis at each of the sites. So because I think the UN Secretary General's decision to invest in this, you know, there's a lot of kind of factors around that workplace and what's going in that workplace and the funding and the sort of political environment. So a close analysis of that little world would tell you a lot about. So the fact that I'm doing this fieldwork at this particular site and focusing on this particular group of people is not necessarily saying that they're the only one that will have will be amenable to intervention. But I think that what I'm saying at the end is that there, a lot of what I see in terms of engagements with contemporary technology from law are concerned with, we need to throw this normative net over it. We need to get better principles. We need to build in the judicial review and so on. And I'm not saying that's bad and should be stopped. I'm just saying there seems to be that's making a big bet that I think is actually quite wrong in some instances. So if we work up an analysis and improve fluency in the kind of governance style that is occurring in these through a kind of, more, well, dare I say it, bottom up. No, but I mean, it's not necessarily bottom up, I wouldn't say that, but through an analysis that perceives the critical possibility very, very closely integrated with the that which is being studied, so cleaves very closely to that which is by which it is concerned. That seems to me quite a promising type of mode of intervention, but it could be one that would take place, and ideally would be taking place, and is in fact taking place in all the sites I described. The question of strategy. So I guess this is embedded in a set of strategies, including those set out in, for example, the 2011 economic plan, which has a strategy, and there's other, the Indonesian government has a strategy around funding and supporting the startup sector and so forth.
But
so
it's from the startup. They should develop these strategies, not from top down. What I would like to see is discovering this startup innovative and build a strategy at bottom level, fitting to the policy of government. This iteration aspect is what I mean.
I think you're not alone in that. So in responding to Emily's thing, I think that a lot of people have this view. So that's why I say policy is actually being prototyped. Strategy is being prototyped. A lot of people have this view that you'll accumulate a good strategy if you just work it up from this. So that's precisely the kind of... So your impulse is the impulse that I see in Pulse Lab Jakarta. What I'm interested in is not so much in developing the strategy that will facilitate that. What I have in mind is a different strategy, which is... So we know for decades... scholars in a range of related fields have been concerned with a different type of strategy, or I would say tactic, which is let's figure out or let's get better at seeing the violence that is done, and they said, you know, let's get better at seeing the problems and the dilemmas.
Yeah, but that's the data. They will tell you the problems. That's the data. That's why you need the analytics need a platform, large platform. I don't think are available. You need the data. It's all this integration of these techniques with the policy. Then you can reach this object.
Yeah, but I guess what Scott tells us is that you can have a problem that exists at the level of style. that there are particular forms of violence or particular forms of domination or other that perform and are reproduced at the level of style. So I'm not the types of problems that are fixed by more data, like data error, you know, whatever it is, the wrong type of data. Those are not. I'm interested in the problems that occupy the level of style or are reproduced through style, and those are not correctable through more data. So if you, I mean, you may not accept that argument, but the argument that so I'm working sort of on the assumption that that there have been a good century's worth of work and more that has shown that has made a good case that problems get reproduced at the level of style.
Well, that's a very pithy place to end, I think, and we do have to close at this point. I must say, from where I've been sitting, it's been wonderful to watch people's faces move from interest to surprise to wonder to recognition. And it's also great to have such a great turnout today, because we have a few competing events. And I must say, in an act of true digital altruism, your last Twitter note, I think, was an invitation to the other events that are happening in the LSE at this time. So thank you all for turning up. And our thanks to Fleur. And excuse me, I just